students and different levels of people, whoever have joined us. So sleep, like we said, is a strong base and a pillar for health, and which I will keep reinforcing and reiterating throughout this talk multiple times. Aim being, or the message being, that whenever I talk to students, I feel that they should go back home with at least just maybe one or two things that they feel that they have learned. I think we are in this era of webinars, and I'm sure with your field, and in our field, it's called as webinar coma now, that people have got so much information dissemination, but we need to take a few things home.
Right, right.
So without kind of going over anything else, I'm going to, this presentation is very light, it's very short. I have gone over the almost 80 questions that I received, which was, I think, a good idea. It kind of gives me a feel, and those questions help me to further, whenever I do some presentations, it's always nice to know what are the people wanting other than what I want to tell them. So I've kind of structured it on those questions, and we'll go through this short presentation, as I said, and then we can discuss more in an open forum.
Right. So, first, ma'am, before we start this presentation, just one request with all the participants. Since ma'am will be running our PPT, we can keep our cameras and microphones off whenever there is a question, maybe towards the end of the talk, then we can ask her, or you can write down the questions.
Yeah, so I think the other thing is that during the talk, then they will just write down the questions. No, there's no something like a chat session which happens in Zoom. So we'll address questions at the end, and maybe you can just club them together and go over them, you know, otherwise it will become difficult.
Yes, yes.
Okay, so let me see. I'm doing this in Google Meet for the first time, so hopefully I will be able to.
Okay. It will go smoothly.
Yeah. So is this okay?
Yes, ma'am. This okay. Is okay. We can see.
Yeah, all right. So the topic today is sleep, influence on health and mind. Okay. So the outline of the talk is going to be, what is sleep? Why do we sleep? What is normal sleep? So I feel that only if we understand these few things, then we can come to this important connection or direction between each other, that the impact of poor sleep on health and mind. And yes, we do like to always end with what can we do to improve our sleep. So this question many people answered, and it was and as expected, let's say, there was a wide range. So the range, in fact, began with some people had 4 hours of sleep, 5, 6, 7, 8. I think bulk of them were around between 6 and 7, but there were some people who've said 4 and 5. So I think after this, I do hope that the ones who are in that 4-5 hour sleep duration would have decided that let me increase my sleep duration and how one can do that. And this is the other dimension of sleep, which we will discuss in a little bit more detail. Do you think you get a good amount of sleep? So could be the next question also be, could be that not only amount, do you think that you are happy with your sleep quality? And we do know that it's not only the quantity of sleep, but the quality of sleep, which again, I will go into more details. This is an important slide, which will make you realize that is there any issue with your sleep, yes or no? Do you get up feeling loving? Do you get up feeling worried? Do you wake up feeling irritable, content, disappointed, confused, heavy head, fog, as many people call it? So I'm not saying that all these conditions could be because of a poor night, but let's say a large proportion of how you feel in the morning depends upon what the night has been. So these are the questions which were there in those 80 questions that I got, and I will just I grouped them into some so that they could be easier to be easily addressed. How many hours of sleep does one need? This question has been asked by a lot of people. And the other question has been asked is that how to fall asleep faster? And something along with that is how to improve sleep quality, how to feel refreshed on waking up. There were some people who asked about the morning and the evening preference. We will touch upon that also. This was an interesting question. Can we decrease the sleep time? And I can share with you, this has been my constant endeavor too, that can we decrease the sleep time? But after learning a lot about sleep, I don't think I want to decrease it any further. Can one break the total duration of sleep into two parts? This is also what we will discuss, as lots of teenagers, early 20s tend to do this and they think that this works. We can discuss that and the role of naps. So we do have a lot of ground to cover. I'll go over the basic aspects of sleep, and in those, when I'm discussing, you will get some of the answers to this. So then coming to this next important question, that so what is sleep? Sleep for many years was thought that it's a passive process. In fact, somebody very nicely said that people have a vision that there is a sign put outside or outside your brain which says do not disturb. It could be true that there's a sign, but it doesn't mean that there's nothing happening in the body. So there are a few facts about sleep which we should be aware of. That is that 1/3 of our life, of our lifespan, we spend in sleep. So if you are 20, you've already spent that many years, total number of years have gone into sleep. And second important thing is that sleep varies with the age, the sleep requirement and the sleep quantity, quality both. So we know children need about 14, 16 hours of sleep. Teenagers will need lesser, about 8 to 9 hours. Adults need about 7 to 8. And the elderly have a much poorer sleep quality and lesser duration. But the most important thing at the end of this talk, which we need to both or all agree on, that sleep is a very active process. And I will show you a little bit what happens in the brain and what happens in the body during sleep. So what was thought for many years, that is sleep like a black box which nobody knows what happens? That principle has been refuted. How? Because we can now measure sleep, and we can also measure activity in the brain through various imaging techniques, know exactly how much oxygen the brain is taking up, how much glucose it is taking up, and that shows us that the brain is very active in sleep. And we come to this something called as the stages of sleep, which some of you may be knowing because of the ability to measure sleep through all these tracking processes. This figure, the picture I put because people are familiar with this individual. We do know that he was a chronic insomniac, and in this desire to get good sleep, he kept increasing the medications, demanding more and more, and which can also be lead to your demise. So sleep issues can be very severe. They can be mild, they can be moderate, or they can be very severe. This is something that I talked about, sleep across the lifespan. But let's say teenagers need about 8 to 9, adults need about 7 to 8. But like we had discussed, and as we discussed your sample as well, there is a range. So it's not fixed that everybody has to get 7, everybody has to get 8. There is a range. But less than 6 hours for an adult is called as a short sleeper, and more than 9 hours in an adult is called as a long sleeper. And this is a bell-shaped curve, that either ends of this are related to poorer health. So that's how the relationship goes. We can measure sleep now. We don't have time for this, but yes, this is a sleep labs. You have gadgets, you have sensors. These are the belts which measure respiration. We have something on the finger which will measure oxygen. We put electrodes or sensors on the brain which can measure your brain activity. Based on this, we get something called as stages of sleep. This chart or picture diagram shows you what is called as a hypnogram. What does it mean? It just says that we have different stages of sleep. we go from the awake state to a light stage, that is stage one, go a little bit more deeper, that is stage two, and then we go into something called stage three and four were called earlier, now together called as slow wave sleep. And this is followed by REM. REM is called as rapid eye movement, also called as the dream sleep, also called as a very active sleep. This together is called as one cycle of sleep. During the night, we have 4 to 5 such cycles. So why is this important? This stages of sleep and how they progress through the night is what gives you the dimension of quality of sleep. So an individual can be in bed for 8 hours and have no slow wave sleep. That person is going to wake up feeling exhausted, tired, unrested, and just angry. You may have all stages of sleep, you have no REM sleep. REM sleep is for learning, memory consolidation. So the slow wave sleep and the non-REM is for the physical body, the REM sleep is for the brain. So a lack of any of these will impact. I just went to the end. One second. I will have to just go back. Let me. So how do we know this? That the sleep is a very active process? Just to show you some pictures and diagrams, that this, the red parts are the ones when the brain is very active. And we now know that even in sleep stages, there is a lot of activity in the brain. And the only other thing that you can get from this picture is that there are different areas of the brain which are active in the non-REM and in the REM. So that's very important on how we will learn about what happens to the brain during sleep. Now, of course, we have some other ways to measure sleep. There are a lot of these apps which have come up, fitness trackers have come up. And if you look at, if you do a Google search, you will find apps which can help you sleep better, which can give you some sounds, which can do a mood diary, etc. So there's no end to all of these. What do? They also give you some data about your sleep. So I have now patients coming with data like this. They can show you their snoring. They can also, these kind of reports show you that what is, how much percentage was night sleep, deep sleep. But just want to tell you that these are still under, let's say, a process of evolution, and they are evolving because they are, have some algorithms based on assumptions which will tell you that, okay, this is deep sleep, this is light sleep or REM sleep. What controls the sleep and wakefulness? I like to spend a little time on this because when we will discuss what is it that you can do to improve your sleep, you do need to know what is it that controls the sleep. So if we can take care of those things or situations, you will then improve the night. So just a simple diagram which shows you that this is the brain. This is the lower part of the brain. This is the front of the brain. So there are various connections and they all work together. And it's like a downward, upward kind of a transmission of impulses and secretion of lots of neurochemicals and chemicals which keep one awake or sleep. And there is, this is a model which was thought of some few years ago, that this is like a sleep-wake switch. So if you have an increased activity of this side, then that's more towards the sleep side, and this is for the awake side. So at night, the sleep chemicals will rise, the wake ones will go down, and it's the reverse in the daytime. And by our own habits, we can disrupt the cycle, and that's why the night gets disrupted. But fortunately, we have these two drives. So one drive is called as the sleep, is called as a sleep drive. That means when you wake up in the morning, the tendency to fall asleep should be low. So the drive is low. During the day, this increases gradually and the drive builds up. That means by the time you reach the night, you do begin to feel sleepy, and then you will sleep. There is a second drive, which is called as the circadian drive. This is a independent system with the master controller sitting in the brain, which controls your hormones. And this is an alertness drive. So this is low in the morning, and these two work together to make you productive during the day, and then you get good sleep at night. So how does one interfere with this? What can we do, or what do we do that we disrupt this cycle? Firstly, people who take numerous short naps in the day, they will decrease or suppress the sleep drive. And if you take a lot of caffeine, you will block the sleep drive. For this, if you are exposed to a lot of light towards the night, you will suppress the sleep promoting hormone, that is melatonin. So we need to understand these two to make our day, how to improve the day and how to improve the night. So this is just a simple plant, which was like many years ago, this was noted that this plant was, the leaves would be open in the daytime and they would kind of droop towards the night. And even if you put them in darkness or in the light, this would happen. That means there is an inbuilt system which does this. And these are the three scientists who won the Nobel Prize in 2017 because of their work on this Drosophila fly, which to determine the circadian rhythm cycle or the body clock. So the master clock is in the brain, but we have numerous clocks all over the body, and they all need to function in sync so that our night and day are good. And this is how the hormones run. There's a time of the day where you'll be most productive. There's a time of the day where you will eat, then how you will exercise and your bowel movements and what happens to your hormones. This was a question asked by some people. Is there a preference? Yes, there is a preference. There's a genetic preference. They're called as the morning larks or the evening owls. So what does that mean? The larks are the ones who sleep early, will wake up very early. And the owls will sleep very late at night and then wake up much later in the day. But just to let you know that 70% of people usually follow a normal sleep routine. 20% are night owls and 10% morning larks. Another thing, the younger people tend to be more night owls. And as you grow older, you tend to become morning larks. So there is a lot of science behind this. There is definitely a genetic tendency. But in addition to that, we have our own habits. And those are increased screen time, deciding voluntary sleep restriction, we call it, or voluntarily delaying the sleep and bedtime. So you may think that you are an evening type, but you have made yourself an evening type by just staying awake till 3 a.m., 4 a.m. And unfortunately, in the society that we live in, we still need to conform to this morningness type of work. So we need to work for the people who have a genetic problem. They will need to work on this definitely. So the three pillars of health, we know over the last few years a lot about nutrition and exercise. But I think we need to understand that sleep is in fact founding the foundation of these. These metrics I've talked about, the quality, the quantity, and the timing. I hope we are now clear about all the three metrics. So why do we sleep? Coming to briefly about what happens in the brain in a little bit more detail. I'm not going to talk about all the adverse effects of poor sleep, but if you take each one of these mentioned here, there is enough data, enough science, which has proven that how lack of sleep can increase your blood sugar, can increase your blood pressure, makes you more prone to get heart attacks, what it does to your mood. But I'm going to talk about two things. One is the emotion and one is the memory, which is more, I thought, relevant to this group. And this is the accidents, which are a big. Three, four things which are very important. What is the role in learning and memory? So we all go through this, that during the day, we are presented with a lot of information. That information needs to be received, it needs to be stored, and then there is a recap. This whole cycle is reinforced or cemented, what we call, at night. And I will just show you how it does. If you remember these just two, three analogies which we've said. So it's been discovered now recently. It was not very clear how this is happening, but now with this techniques that one can see, there is like a cleaning up of the brain happening at night. So the garbage which collects, the brain is processing information. It's like working. When somebody works, there is a release of some material which is not required. That waste has to be removed. And that removal happens at night. That's called like a, you may call it vacuum cleaning, you may call it removal of garbage. People have called it like weeding of the garden. That's what happens. The other big thing is that there's an organ or the center of the brain that's called small little thing called hippocampus, which is very important for memory. It's been seen that lack of sleep has caused changes. So this is just to show you, this was actually that this is the blood vessels in the brain, the blue side. When you are awake, that's how it flows. But at night, somehow they saw a lot of activity around it. And there is this extra kind of a fluid. And this system is called as a G lymphatic system now. This starts removing all the junk. So when we cut the night sleep, this removal of junk will not happen, or garbage will not happen. And the brain will get cluttered with these deposits. This now are known that they may land up causing memory problems later on in life. And another thing, just a simple picture or a way to remember it is, it's as if the weeds are being taken off and your garden looks nice and ready for the day. So that's one part, that it gets cleaned. Second part is that it gets information gets stored. So whatever you are receiving, it goes into something called as a hard disk. And hard disk is the hippocampus. And from hippocampus, then when we want to recall, it kind of comes back. These experiments have been done with students when they were given something to learn and then allowed to sleep. And on waking up, they did a recall. And it was found that those who had good quality quantity of sleep, the recall was much better. Whereas in the second group, they gave them the same information to learn, but they interrupted the sleep a lot. They fragmented it as an experiment. And they found those people, they had an impaired recall. What about emotions? I just want to say that this is again very clear, but I will just tell you why and how it happens. Lack of sleep can cause anger, irritability, but what is even more concerning, it can make you take what is called as risky decisions, and it decreases empathy. So which are great issues if one is going to be living in the social world. So it can do all this to you. Whereas a good sleep will produce a very happy, content, energetic person. It can cause nightmares and it can cause anxiety. So how does this happen? There is a very small structure, again, like in the center of the brain. This is called as the amygdala. It's like almost like an almond-sized structure. This is the center of anger, fear, etc. Usually, when there is good sleep, there is this front of the brain which kind of has a dampening effect on this. And when the sleep is poor, this effect is gone. So that means you will become fearful, you will become angry, irritable, and it has been seen that lack of sleep is associated, particularly in youngsters, with substance abuse, alcohol abuse, etc. So there is a lot of relationship between all this and risky decisions. And of course, now we have the virus, which has added to the sleep issues in life. It has become made people more stressful. There is uncertainty, there is anxiety, a lot of frustration, which are all causing a poor sleep. And there's this interesting term called coronasomnia. I'm just quoting from this clinical psychologist who says that everything that's going on right now can make people very vulnerable to insomnia. And it's a vicious cycle. When you lose sleep, your emotions can make you feel more intense. Your ability to regulate emotions also becomes diminished. And these stressors will further impair sleep. So it's like a vicious cycle. The third thing that I want to talk about is the relationship with your appetite. So you might wonder, why is this important? There are two hormones in the body. One is called ghrelin and one is called leptin. The ghrelin tells you that you must eat. And the leptin tells you that, okay, stop eating. When you have good sleep, these are in a balanced state. But a poor sleep causes the reverse. That means there's a increase in ghrelin, which increases your appetite. And there's a decrease in leptin, which suppresses the appetite. So what will happen? You will tend to eat a lot more. It does another thing. It actually changes your choices of food. So you tend to eat a lot of wrong things. And that's what it makes you do. So at night, cravings for carbohydrate-rich food is what lack of sleep can do. So I hope I have convinced you that we've gone over some points, but basically that lack of sleep can affect almost all parts of the body. What are the common problems? We are not going to be talking about common problems, I mean the symptoms, etc. But basically it's those that say, I can't sleep. Somebody says, I'm very sleepy in the daytime. And some people have things like sleep talking, walking, etc. But just to say that there is a very strong relationship, which is obvious, between the day and the night. So we may think symptoms are happening at night, but whatever we do in the day or whatever we feel in the day, they are both interrelated. And that's what we need to remember. So coming to this thing that, okay, now, so what can we do to improve sleep? I talked about 2-3 concerns when I talked about the control of sleep and wakefulness. We had these 2-3 drives. So we need to improve the sleep drive and we need to decrease the wake drive to get a good sleep. It's as simple as that. So the other mantra that I say, the body needs to be tired and the brain needs to be relaxed. Putting together all these tips together is this word, something called as sleep hygiene. We are anyway focusing a lot on hygiene these days, you know, personal hygiene, cleaning of hands, wearing masks, taking care of your breath. I think it's time that we start focusing on this as well. So certain do's that you do, all the relaxing activities, get a good amount of light at night and during the day. Keep a fixed time for sleep time and wake up time. Please do not fluctuate this. Your circadian system gets very confused. Relaxing activities at night, healthy food at night. Avoid things like screen time, too much of caffeine, smoking, and exercise is good, but not late night gyms and exercises. And this to put together, what should you do, what you should not do, is you will get, these are called as sleep tips for sleep hygiene. The other thing, I just want to put this here, because also when we have peers who say that, you know, I sleep 4 hours and I do well. Some people wear lack of sleep like a badge of honor. I don't think we should do that. The whole effort in this talk has been to talk about the importance of sleep and what sleep does for our mental health, physical health, and emotional health. So we should not take it very lightly and just say that, you know, I can function. Whether they function, whether they not, do not, we don't know. Most importantly, so we've tried all this, and when should one seek help? I think simply 2-3 things, that if you feel that you are just not able to function during the day, you have tried the sleep hygiene measures, definitely first step is to identify your own culprits, as I call them, which are interfering with sleep, but issues are not getting resolved. You still get up with a very fuzzy head, can't work, can't concentrate. And if you need to resort to something like sleep aids could be substance abuse, could be sleeping pills, alcohol, it is time to seek help and you will get helped for all the sleep issues. So to conclude, I want to put these things together, that sleep is a complex process, and the myth for many years that it's a passive process has been dispelled. It's an active process. It's the most cheapest, inexpensive, easily available remedy for almost all maladies, and it exists within us. So I again emphasize that we need to prioritize sleep, and you need to take charge of your own sleep. So these questions that we started with, how many hours of sleep does one need? How to fall asleep faster? We will discuss that. That's basically to decrease the stimulation. Do not allow yourself to lie in bed and wait for sleep. How to improve sleep quality is how to build your sleep drive. So during the day, short naps are not to be taken. Take away things like caffeine. And how to feel refreshed is if you get a good quality. Can we decrease the sleep time? No, actually really not. So you see how much you need and you stick to that. Can one break the sleep into two parts? No, because we have a certain pattern at night when the hormones peak and go down. So, and I showed you the number of cycles we need. So we can't say that we'll take one cycle there and one cycle. Naps are a good thing to do. They are called power naps, but what time of the day? Before 3 p.m., the duration, just about 15 to 20 minutes. This was a book that I had written a little while ago. It is on Amazon. It's kind of put these things more in a simplified fashion and gone a little bit more into details with case studies and how one can improve one's sleep. Recently, I've also started putting some courses online for helping people to sleep, and that is an online platform called as a Sleep Medicine Institute, but that's our email. And I would like to thank you all for your attention and giving me this opportunity to share what we have learned over the years about sleep, and hoping that we can make a change in your life about sleep.
Thank you very much, ma'am. It is very beneficial for us and thought provoking as well, because as you said, lack of sleep, or those who are not sleeping at night, getting proper sleep at night, it should not be worn as a badge of honor. Yeah. which we see quite frequently when students tell each other that, you know, I remain fresh even after
some comments that people are sleeping 4 hours and saying I have no problem with sleep. I mean, it's very good, but it might have a toll on you sometime or the other.
Plus, also the lifestyle which we have, the kind of work in which we indulge. Like, there are leaders and celebrities who take very little sleep, but they go on doing their work, and it's like we do not see an impact of lack of sleep on them. But yeah, of course, it depends a lot on the lifestyle and the work they are doing. Yes, of course, and the age group, as you mentioned. Yeah.
So if there are some other questions which you have, then we can just go over them.
Okay, ma'am, can you see the chat as well?
Yeah, I won't. Okay, so I'll have to, they're going faster than I thought. So some you will see. So there are one, two I read just now, that role of CBT. CBT is... for the people who don't know what is CBT, it is cognitive behavioral therapy. Cognitive behavioral therapy is a technique which the psychologists have for treating many things. For CBT, I is a cognitive behavioral therapy for insomnia. It has a few components to it. One of them is sleep hygiene. Then we have sleep restriction. We have stimulus control. We have relaxation. But just to put it simply, it is to enhance your own sleep drive, build your circadian system so that you get a good sleep. And this is I have actually started doing this for my patients now. It's a 4 to 6 week kind of a program. And you go through each week, you go through one set of rules, and we have a sleep diary, how to fill it. So I can also say that the sleep diary part is available free on that Sleep Medicine Institute. So if any student wants to fill their own sleep diary, how to analyze their sleep diary, it gives you a lot of insight as to what I'm doing wrong or right. What was the other question? Bad dream. Yeah, you know, so dreams are, I never used to get into dreams because I think it's a very more a psychology domain, but I think the dreams have become forefront in the last few months in any case. It's a very fascinating topic, but just want to say a few things about dreams. Dreams are like little snapshots which about of your life or of your day, which will kind of get strung together, maybe not in a sequence or not in a good order at night. And particularly now that what the stage that we are going through, there is a lot of fear, anxiety, worry, frustration from self, family, health, whatever. These are getting a little disjointed and getting confused at night. And that's why people are getting very fearful dreams. That's one. Second, people are indulging a lot in watching certain shows at night, very late at night, and those are still lingering. So I continuously tell all the students and the patients that the brain is not like a computer that you shut the screen and it shuts off. It's still active. So whatever you feed it last, it will remain like that, or whatever you have done in the day. So that's why we keep saying that please focus on your day to improve your night, and especially pre-bedtime ritual or routine is very important. What are the other questions? Okay, how is the sleep?
Yeah, ma'am, one interesting question here put by Nupur. I cannot sleep without a particular position, which is a wrong one. And if I try right position, my body pains and cannot sleep. So a particular...
there are two very missing links in that. What is the wrong position? What is the right position? So that is that you have assumed it's wrong or right. I don't know what is wrong or right. So maybe position for
you. Yeah, is there any right sleep position? No.
There's no really right or wrong position. You can sleep on your sides, you can sleep on your back, you can people sleep on their face. But yes, people who sleep straight on their back, if they are loud snorers, very obese, we always tell them to sleep on the side. Okay. And for children, we don't like them to sleep on their face because you can kind of choke. People who have epilepsy and stuff like that, we say don't sleep on your face because it can harm you. But otherwise, don't worry too much. How safe is it to take? So some I'll read, but some you collect because it kind of, in my screen, it comes up and goes off. I can't review them again. Melatonin. So melatonin, we discussed briefly, is a hormone chemical, which is a sleep inducer. It starts kind of rising towards the evening, peaks at night, and then it comes down. Now, when we are stimulating our eyes or our brain with light, we suppress the melatonin. So somebody asked about taking melatonin. So when we take melatonin, you have to be very sure what are you taking it for. See, I have seen a lot of students now who take the melatonin, but they are watching Netflix till 2 a.m. So then it's kind of contradiction to each other. So you take a hormone to induce sleep, but you have lights which suppress the melatonin. And then they'll come and tell me melatonin didn't do a thing for me. That's one part. Second is the timing of taking that you take melatonin. So melatonin is not something like you take it at night at about 11 p.m. or 1 a.m. and say, oh, I'll sleep in 10 minutes. It won't act. It has to be very slow. So in short, whatever we do to improve sleep, we should work with the sleep hygiene tips. And then yes, melatonin does help, taken under guidance. And then somebody will tell you how long it should be taken for. Somebody's asked about sleep paralysis 2-3 times. Right. Sleep paralysis is an entity. So firstly, for the others who don't know what is sleep paralysis, it's a feeling that you get that I can't, it's exactly as the word says, it is sleep and paralysis, meaning your body feels as if it's paralyzed. You can't speak, you can't move, and you may have a feeling that it's like something like a big heavy thing sitting on my chest or somebody squeezing me or whatever.
Choking sensation.
But these are very short duration. And they usually will get better by itself within a few seconds or less than a minute, and somebody can shake you. They can occur in the beginning of the night, middle or latter part. So why do they occur? This is an intrusion of a REM state into a partial wakefulness state. That means your body is like paralyzed, but you're kind of partly awake. So the domain between sleep and wakefulness has got a little confused. And what can you do about it? So if sleep paralysis is occurring by itself, then it usually comes around this age, comes with a lot of stress, anxiety, your quality of sleep, basically it's a sign it's not very smooth. We're not transitioning from one state to the other nicely. So make sure that you get good amount of sleep, good quality of sleep, focus on your day. But if we didn't talk about disorders, but if anybody who has sleep paralysis and has also another symptom of feeling very, very sleepy in the day, or even in any or he feels excessively sleepy in the day, can't focus at all during the classes in spite of getting a good night, and that is a medical condition which comes up at this age. Average duration of miss or delay diagnosis is 5 to 7 years. So I have seen a lot of those children. So they suffer a lot because people call them lazy children, that your night is bad, you're just lazy, you have no motivation, etc. But they have a disorder. Next. Anything else that you can see?
Okay, so Sandeep Kumar Agrawal has asked, what to do if you're not able to relax your mind before sleep?
So that is the big question which everybody has. So like I said, the more you think about sleep, the sleep is going to become a problem. So we need to have like that routine. So like we plan the day. Now there is enough guidelines and evidence that we need to plan the bedtime. So you get up in the morning, you have your plan that I will get ready, I will do this, I will do this. Similarly for night, just have a plan that I will watch whatever my show, or I'll talk to my friends, then I'll put my phones off. Then I will read, then I can have a nice shower. And then you have to find a technique on how to relax. So of course, she knows that there are relaxation techniques available, which, what are they doing? They are simply taking your mind off the continuous chatter that it goes into. And you need to remove that and focus on something else. It could be just a simple thing like focusing on one's breath, for instance. And I also want to say that I have seen a lot of people who say, you know, I tried meditation. So meditation, I don't think is so simple. And that the brain is not going to be able to relax just with trying to do meditation yourself. So try simple things yourself, try simple techniques which will work.
Yeah, right. Like maybe reading a boring book.
Reading or a boring book and or reading something which is light.
Which is light, right.
Yeah. What are they saying? Somebody's asking about sleep in the afternoon. I think somebody else asked about this double sleep, that you can have some sleep at night and day. At night and day, we've discussed that, you know, we need a continuity of that many cycles. If you take a short nap in the day, you won't get any REM sleep. So we need that much REM at night to consolidate our memory. So that's the answer for that. Naps, I said, yes, naps are good. But timing of the day, if you take a nap 6 p.m., then you'll be prepared the night is going to be bad. Because remember, we discussed the sleep drive. You have killed the sleep drive. So it's exactly like food intake. The longer you stay hungry, the more hungry you will be. So the longer you stay awake, the more sleepy you will get. So the timing the nap, 3 p.m., before 3 p.m., 15 to 20 minutes nap is fine.
Okay.
Somebody's asking about ideal time for dinner. So there's a big, big story about food and sleep, which we've not had time to touch. But early dinner is what we advise. Again, it has a scientific basis. So whatever was said, I think, in the past, we were saying things, but now those have got those. Remember, those things were early to bed and early to rise and stuff. So an early dinner, because your metabolism starts slowing down after that. You get more chances of getting insulin resistance if you eat late, heavy meals. So light dinner and early dinner.
And ma'am, how much time should be there in between?
Ideally about one and a half to 2 hours.
Okay. Ma'am, Avanti has asked how to reduce the physical movements during sleep, like talking or laughing or sudden abnormal movements.
Yeah, so this is the third. So the sleep we discussed, have the major presentations are 2-3 types. One is this poor sleep, one is feeling very sleepy, and third is this abnormal behavior. So this abnormal behavior, like I mentioned, it's basically there's an intrusion of that wakefulness into sleep. So the partly the brain is awake, partly asleep. That's how you're doing all these things. So there's talking, there is walking, etc. So we need to improve the depth of sleep and the continuity of sleep. And that's, again, you have to figure out what is it that you do wrong. So people who have sleep deprivation, meaning that 5 nights I have a project to submit or something, you're sleeping 4 hours, 5 hours, and then you will have catch-up sleep. Then again, you will not have sleep. So those people get a lot of these. That's one. Second is there is a familial tendency also. So check if your family, somebody else was sleep talking, walking, etc. And third, we have some disorders. But disorders we'll keep down first. Let's. Somebody talked about sleep debt. Is it a myth? No, sleep debt is a very realistic condition or a term. It basically means that if your body needs 7 hours, and you get 5 hours, so you have 2 hours debt. Now in this whole week, you someday slept 5 hours, somebody 4 hours, 5 hours, 3 hours, whatever, you will accumulate that debt. Mm-hmm. And like I was mentioning some experiments, there's enough experiments done to show that even one night of a bad sleep totally disrupts your sugars, your learning, etc. So initially it was thought that 1 week, and a lot of people do this, they sleep 5 hours, on the weekend they will sleep 12 hours. So it will not take care of your metabolic problems. In fact, there's this study which has come, which is related to this immunity. It was published a little while ago, it's got nothing to do with the corona right now, is that there was a group of students in DC that they gave direct common cold virus into the nose. And the ones who had slept well the previous week had much less chances of infection. Whereas the ones who had poor sleep got infected much more easily. And similar study has come about vaccinations, that the ones who slept well had a better antibody response. And so they're saying that we should time our vaccinations to the time that makes sure we get good rest. So immunity is another area which we didn't touch, but it's very important to, there's a like a army, you can call it, or soldiers or whatever. During sleep, they get prepared to fight the infections.
Okay, so ma'am, another question from Anurag Bore. For persons in shift rotation job, how do they manage sleep?
Yeah, so that's, we call it like a total disruption of their circadian rhythm. That, sorry, they are supposed to be asleep, but they are awake. You know, so there is a criteria for that how frequent should the shift changes be, that you can't move them every 2 days back and forth. So at least 4 days they have to be in a shift, then they have to get a certain period of rest, then they have to go to another shift. That's one. Second is that they need to follow principles for the sleep hygiene even more strictly. That you can't just have them the whole time just lying in bed, then getting up and coming for the duty. So they need to fit in their exercise time, their meal times, all that has to be, they have to be much more careful. Otherwise, it will impact their health.
The body starts recognizing a pattern, and then to introduce a new kind of routine.
It is hard, but you have to work on it. It's like, so other day, I mean, you are a psychologist, so you know, we were talking about that for everything, I feel now is behavioral modification.
Right.
So we can tell people, do this, do that, do this, do that. It's they say we can't do it. So, I mean, for that, then I also have a psychologist with me, who I refer, and I say that. So we need to understand why they can't do it and then help them to do it. And right. Another thing is that you may not achieve everything. So make little small changes what you can. Sunlight definitely helps to increase wakefulness because it shuts off that part of the brain which is producing melatonin. So during this corona times, the three tips are keep a fixed time for sleep and wake up and get adequate amount of daylight, good physical activity, and decreased stimulation and screen times. So that will ensure.
Ma'am, Yatharth has asked, what is the difference between polyphasic sleep and monophasic sleep? And I think there's another part to it. Complete my sleep in 3-4 times in whole day. Some suggest it is unhealthy.
Yeah, so that's what we discussed, no? That this is what he's saying, that he's taking multiple naps the whole day. So if you think about it, each cycle which I was talking about is about 90 minutes or something like that. And you need that many cycles at night to get the total benefit. So if I keep taking multiple naps in the day, you won't get those complete cycles. So it will impact your health. sooner or later. So in 20s, people feel that 30, 40s are very far away, but it will come very fast.
So Talha has asked something similar. If I sleep for long durations, will that help in delaying the aging process?
No. So we said the shape, that less than 6 hours, more than 9 hours, you can't just sleep and to get delay the aging. But we need right amount of sleep, let's say, to delay the aging.
Okay.
It goes off very fast. Have asked
the questions multiple times. That's why something about sleep apnea, ma'am. Sleep apnea.
Yeah. So we didn't talk about sleep apnea. So this is another entity where the common symptom is snoring. So the first symptom of the predominant symptom is snoring, and with the snoring there comes tiredness in the day. So the other way around to look at it is that those people who say that they are extremely exhausted, tired in the day, one should go back and think that is there snoring? So that is a condition called a sleep apnea. So what does it mean? That during sleep, apnea means a pause in breath. So snoring is one end of the spectrum and severe sleep apnea is the other. So with the snoring, if the breathing stops for more than 10 seconds and more than at least 5 to 10 times per hour, it is sleep apnea. But what it does to the sleep is it disturbs the continuity. It breaks the sleep. So people are just very exhausted in the morning. They can't focus. They can't be productive. So it's all the signs of a poor bad or a bad night, as we call it.
Okay. Ma'am, our registrar sir has asked, do the blind have a different quantum of sleep requirements than the normal?
Yeah, no. So blind actually have a real problem because we talked about the circadian rhythm. So the circadian rhythm, we have certain cues which set the cycle. They're called as the zeit givers. So one of them is light. So that's why we keep saying get light exposure, that you know your melatonin will be stopped, or when you are darkness, the melatonin will rise. So in them, what happens is that they have a 24-hour cycle. So the melatonin keeps going up and down by itself, but they don't have external cue, which is a big cue, is a light. So sometimes they go into something called as a free running cycle. That means they tend to do this, that they sleep, then they wake up, and they sleep, then they wake up. So their sleep gets what this somebody was asking. But it has a harmful effect on them. So you train them by training all the other things, like their meal times get trained, the exercise gets fitted in, then their night will automatically shift. But they have a great tendency to move from that regular night pattern into the multiple naps in a daytime. So it can create a problem.
Okay. Azad Gupta is asking how to convince a 5 to 10 year old to sleep. They are too restless and bedtime stories make them.
Yeah. So that's my next project. I've done two courses which are on Udemy and this Sleep Medicine Institute. One is for adults and one was actually teenagers, but Udemy didn't want the word teenagers, so I've just put it as how to sleep better. I don't know, they said remove the word teenager. But that's the one that I'm seeing nowadays. I mean, they're really troubled because the schools have opened up or colleges have opened up and they're not able to function. So third thing, what I was coming to were these toddlers, these children, small children. So if the children are not sleeping well, the parents will not sleep well.
True.
And so it's a vicious cycle. But like we talk about setting sleep routine, here we've talked about adults or whatever. Similar pattern we have to follow for children. So what time is their nap time? How much is the nap? They take a nap in the evening, they are bound to stay awake at night. We have to have a winding down routine for them, a calming. So you can't just read a book for a little while, but the rest of the day he's been very hectic and he's taken an evening nap. He won't sleep. I have children who are sleeping. I mean, the parents are telling me that children are sleeping at 11, 12, so which is harmful for the child. So child needs sleep even more because that's the time the brain is just consolidating and memories and the synapses are growing. So we need to ensure they get that good sleep.
Okay.
Should we start winding up?
Okay, ma'am. Although we have still questions coming up, it is one such topic which everyone wants to know about and clear their doubts. Okay, ma'am, just one, two questions more.
हाँ
Dr. Sandeep Pathak has asked, is there any best direction to sleep better according to Vastu Shastra? Sleeping in the eighth direction is good. So what is your advice on this?
I don't know. So maybe let's say the science that we do, we haven't studied it scientifically, to simply put it, you know. I mean, it's not in my domain, and I don't think we've studied from the scientific research base. See, all that we can say is that, so I can't say.
Okay, and do the yoga practices, they have an impact on quality and quantity of life? Although we hear about it, we keep on
yes,
hearing
about it. Yes, so see, if you were to group the yoga practices as together, most of them, what are they doing? They are doing something like relaxation techniques, some of them, you know, so, and they will give you some stretching and some, so they have two components to it. One is the physical component to it, and one is, let's say, it's the mental component to it.
Mm-hmm.
So the physical has worked well, especially during this time of lockdown, and people have not been able to go out. So it's a good idea to, at least that way the body, all your parts will move, you will get some physical activity and mobility and flexibility. Things like Shavasana, Pranayama, which we published also, I've published some work with IIT people with this. It does a lot to improve your parasympathetic system, which is a relaxing system. And that's what we need. So before, towards the end of the day, if we can calm our brain, decrease this wakeful drive or the sympathetic system, so it will help. So pranayam, a simple pranayam, helps a lot. It will definitely help.
Ma'am, is it right that people can actually solve their problems
in sleep?
Yes.
Yeah, so this is interesting thing, because remember long time back there used to be this thing that sleep on it. So that's what people are now saying. There is some research also which has come on this, that if you're given a problem sometimes and you sleep on it, you might find a solution in the morning. So that process, they are linking to what I showed, what's happening in the brain, that we are able to pick up things and put them together. So it's like a pruning which happens. So the useless information gets cleared off. So somebody said very nicely that it's not only that everything is removed, it's what is not necessary is removed, and what is necessary remains behind, and that sometimes gets connected. I don't know whether you felt, but I have experienced that if there is a problem sometimes when you sleep on it, I mean, you do come up with some answer. So whether that remained in the back of your mind, and I used to show a slide which is like a jigsaw puzzle, that you, the puzzle pieces kind of start fitting together. So there is a very interest. I found this, that sleep on it, which people said it is working. Now we know why it works, maybe because the brain, there's a lot of things happening in the brain at night.
Right. And ma'am, one last thing on lucid dreaming. Students are curious about lucid dreaming.
I see, like I said, the dreams I don't like to really go into. So lucid dreaming is, you know, this again, this thought that I can control my dream or during my dream. And these dreams is like a total chapter. You can deal with it. But while we do know that, yes, dreams occur. Everybody dreams, firstly. Some you may recall, some you may not recall. But I think this whole concept of this, the thought process and what you do towards the end and you intrude into REM, the theories behind it, I am not yet fully versed.
Yeah, when students approach me in some of the sessions, especially where there is a lot of anxiety,
then they will.
I try to, yeah, I ask them about what exactly are they dreaming about, the loose, the manifest content, the latent content of the dream, because that is more of a psychological thing.
Yeah, that's more of psychology. Yeah, that's what I also, so don't get into it because it's much more.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I thank you on behalf of the ICER community and for this thought-provoking address. And we are all very much inspired by your words. And I would also like to express my deep gratitude to Deputy Director Dr. Saptarishi Mukherjee, Honorable Registrar Sir, for his valuable presence and guidance, and Dean Dr. Tomar and his office for in organizing this session. And my special thanks to Tushar for giving us timely
yes.
help. Thank you so much, Tushar. That was enormous cooperation, I would say. And thank you very much, ma'am.
And thank you so much. I think it was a very, I enjoyed it thoroughly, and I love all the questions always. Okay, bye bye.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Bye bye. All right.